I would like to dedicate this lecture to the memory of my friend Julie Yuri. BDT, we have heard yesterday a very interesting talk from Tayeba and Brain about the BDT and the constraints and restriction for cancer. Today, it is another opportunity for non-oncological applications, and more focus will be on the malaria as well, filaria and dengue fever, schistosomiasis, to be controlled with using the modality of BDT. And then we have what is called phytopesticides or the used derivatives of chlorophyll also against pests. And then we will talk about the implementation in the field. And SAFE is a stand for sunlight active formulated extract. And the field application, we did it in Uganda, Ethiopia, and Sudan, and we'll talk about some future perspectives. I would like to remind you about the history of BDT. It was not new, it is more than 5,000 years, started with the Egyptians and the Indians, as well as Chinese. And the work of Arnold Raab in 1855 developed it till 1999. It was the first drug approved by FDA in Canada. And as you know, that is the light started from sunlight to the most sophisticated instruments and lasers, or the development of photosensitizer started from porphyrin or hematoporphyrin till the newest one existing in the market now. Our target, we started with to do the vector-borne diseases like the vector of malaria, filaria, and the dengue fever, as well as the parasite schistosomiasis, or called bilharziosis. And lately, we will talk about agriculture pests like cotton worm, white fly. These insects made a huge damage for agriculture economy. Our light source, of course, in the laboratory, we are utilizing lasers, LED, we are utilizing solar simulator, but in the field, we utilize direct sunlight. And sunlight, as you know, about 50% in the infrared region. The rest is the photosynthetic regions here, visible light, which is more important for photosensitizers in order to utilize on both sides. We'll see also if you have composites of nanoparticles as well as in chlorophyll derivative, it could be absorbed also not only as a photochemical, but also as a photothermal process proceeds. Our natural photosensitizer you see here extracts from plant chlorophyll A, chlorophyll B. Even the structure is very similar, but you see the spectrum is totally different where you have to oxide it. And most importantly, the chlorophylline copper salts or magnesium salts, where these compounds are water soluble. Three different species of mosquito causes this great damage, or the Culex pepinus causes the filariasis, and this filariasis is very painful and disfiguring disease. And if we would like to see how it is distributed all over the world, you will see, unfortunately, most of them exist in Africa and Egypt. Here, unfortunately, we still have the filariasis, as well as here in Brazil and Indian, as well as the rest in the Asian part. The Aedes aegypti is responsible for the dengue fever, the Rift Valley fever, and this disease is flu-like illness and occasionally develops into potentially lethal complication. And just to have an idea how it is distributed also worldwide, you will find more or less the same Latin America, as well as in Africa and in Indian and Far East countries here. About the malaria, here the These figures from the latest report of WHO 2014, and you will have more than 100 death cases per 1,000 population in every dark area, and this little bit till we would reach 1 till 10 death cases per 1,000 population. You will find this in Brazilian as well as in those part of Africa. The malaria problems, according to WHO 2014, still 3.3 billion people are at risk, and nearly 200 million cases were diagnosed with malaria, and from this, about 584,000 deaths in 2013. Unfortunately, Africa accounts for about 30% of population at risk and 90% of global cases and deaths. And you will find the deaths for children under 5 years represent about 83% of that. And according even to WHO, the statement that the government and the statistics are much less than reality, because the death cases are in small village or in rural area, and so it cannot be really exactly determined. The total amount spent on controlling malaria is estimated to 2.7 billion in 2013. WHO still required or needed 5.1 billion in order to, or according to their argument, that to eradicate malaria, they need this money. Why should we fight malaria? As you see here, DDT, which is strictly restricted and banned and forbidden by Stockholm Convention in 1972, it is still recommended to be used in Africa. A lot of development of resistance to the medicine of malaria, artemisinin and other malaria treatment, increasing disease and death rate. In 53 countries, it has been reported that ineffective malaria vector control due to resistance to pesticides, and believe it or not, life expectancy exceeds 80 years old in developed country. In Africa, the story is totally different. You can imagine that in Zambia, the average of the death is 31 years. This means that we can come to, if malaria is not be treated, about 40% of the world population will suffer the death of this disease. That is the life cycle of malaria. Of course, the stages which live in water is easily to be handled by photodynamic therapy. The adult, it is difficult because it is fed with blood, as you know. And that is why we utilized the photodynamic in water where the swamps or the embedded, where the water, stagnant water in, existing in the swamps in Africa. Here you will find the Culex pepinus larva with the feeded with chlorophyll derivatives, and here it is free without, and if this is submitted to light, which is now encased in the field by sunlight, you know the tissue is transparent, it will absorb the light, it will make oxidation stress, producing singlet oxygen or free radical, exactly as everybody of you know the mechanism of BDT, either mechanism one or mechanism two. In order to have academic thesis or paper, we have to use confocal laser microscopy in order to measure exactly the dynamic behavior of the culex. Here you will find how the culex accumulated, and you can focus in any point of that to determine the concentration or the intercellular interaction between the sensitizers and the tissue. And you will see some results here. I'm not going in details due to time constraints. And by using fluorescence measurements, you can exactly measure the different concentration or the, monitor the distribution of the photosensitizers as a function of time. If you utilize also the time measurements, you can measure the intermediate of fluorescence lifetime, and you can determine exactly the intracellular in dynamic way, the intercellular interaction in dynamic way. Here, if you take transverse section of the larva, that is here you will find before treatment, all microorganisms here or the tissue of the organ are in good health. Here, after BDT treatment, you will find a complete burn of the mosquito. It is really momentan. It is very aggressive, very active if you subjected this to solar radiance. Feeded the larva before that should be distributed or feeded with the chlorophyll derivatives. About schistosoma control, here again the map, you will find fortunately here in Brazil a little bit, but in Africa there's still huge existence of this disease in Africa. And you know the life cycle, it contains eggs, it contains cercaria, it contains worms. And I want just to show you some video of one of these life cycle stage is the cercaria. And this is cercaria that is the infected, that is the hatched from the snails, and each eggs produce about 2,000 cercaria. And if anybody in contact with water, this cercaria can penetrate the skin and go to the portal vein and live in the kidney. And here, you see how it is aggressive, how it is very active, and you cannot see it in naked eyes, and that is before treatment. And after treatment, you will find here 15 minutes only exposure to light, and using about 300 watt per quadrat meter, and this is really a sunny day in Egypt in winter. It is not a quantity of the other, huge quantity of the other intensity of solar irradiance. We will see the difference, how it looks like. I don't know why it does not work. I don't know what happened. But should work. Or you can pick it from the. Yes, welcome. Yes, you see here how the difference between both. Here it was very active, and here even you see the one of the cercarias struggling to survive. One of my co-workers registered that here, that is a difference just by sunlight and distribute the sensitizers in the swamps where, or the small canals of water where this is existing, and it will be killed. Say 1 hour is enough, but in order to be assured, you will have to accumulate it during the night in order to assure that some of the cercaria feeded with the chlorophyll derivatives as sensitizers. The last topics is the using of chlorophyll derivatives as a natural product for agriculture pests. And we have a project here from the supported from the Ministry of Health in Egypt, and it was done in the pilot plant in the agriculture college at Cairo University, and started 2 years ago, and will have half a year to finish this project. And we wanted to utilize not only the photochemical interaction, but also to have to utilize the photothermal effect of the solar energy. And the combination or the nanocomposite between graphite oxides and the chlorophyll produce such a compound, and the efficiency of this is doubled really. We will see the result due to the absorption of the solar irradiance from the sun, either by chlorophyll derivatives or the graphene oxide. Both of them gives a very efficient combination. And here, that is what is called white fly. The agriculture researchers say it is very dangerous insects. It feeded for all the green plants, vegetables, and here before treatment, and here after treatment, and even the poba, the stage here before treatment and after treatment. This means that really the BDT modality, it works. You will spray the sensitizers on the agriculture plant and then follow up the entomological behavior of the insects and the population of the insects. Here, that is the result. You see here about 80% till 85% achievement of the population in using that by using the chlorophyll derivatives, copper chlorophylline. And if we add this copper chlorophylline to the other product like graphene oxides or silver nanocomposite, the efficiency is increased. We'll see another, that is for the magnesium chlorophylline derivative, that more or less the same results. Here, that is the cotton worm. Here it is a piece of the cotton worm paper from the trees, and here the eggs, it is not treated, eggs is treated. The eggs is not treated, it produced the worms, which really eat all the green tree of the cotton worm and make the huge damage for the economy. And here, that is result again. It's interesting to compare if the magnesium chlorophylline alone, that is here the percentage of survival, if the using the magnesium silver nanocomposite or the magnesium graphene oxide nanocomposite, you will find the reduction of the survival by 20 or 15 till 20% of that. This means that it works well just by using the BDT modality with solar energy. Here, that is the cotton worm compared with copper derivative, or the word copper silver nanocomposite or copper graphene oxide nanocomposite. The last topic, the safe, that is the implementation of our product in the field. We have succeeded to have this as a patent in the WIPO field application. It is no more research, but it is really testing and evaluation in the field for malaria vector control using sunlight active formulated extract. And we found that is very effective methods to control the malaria with total friendly. The advantages of safe, you will see here, it is depends on what? Natural extracts chlorophyll, which is approved by FDA as food additives. We environmental friendly, totally environmentally friendly, even it is degraded by the sunlight, and cost effective. You can have it very simple. This non-toxic, non-mutagenic, FDA approved in 2003 as food additive. This means that you are totally talking about green technology, the sunlight and chlorophyll derivatives, easily applied to infested swamps, highly selective to target organism. And that is really the challenging. We adding by safe component, mosquito attractant, just be eaten only by the larva of for example, by the larva of Anopheles, which is responsible for malaria. And the other beneficial microorganisms, doesn't harm because it doesn't eat that. And when the sun shines, it will only produce the photo-oxidation stress on the targeted microorganisms. And here we will find the Minister of Health compared in Uganda small-scale field evaluation of safe bacteria, this is bacteria, depend on Bacillus bacteria as a bio insecticides, and we found that, or they found that the product is very efficient and very cost-effective compared to the others, and that is here the sites of the study in three different places has been done since 2008. And here, that is the Kampala, the main city of Uganda. You will find where the embedded swamps here in this place, or here in this place. If you find mainstream water, you didn't find any malaria or larva of malaria existing in these areas. Here, how it looks like, that is the groups in Uganda. They are doing very sophisticated experiments regarding the type of the water, the other microorganisms, in order to calculate exactly the amount needed for the sensitizer, and study also the different area, which is different from one place to others. Here, these experiments has been done also in Ethiopia, and a lot of results gained from both countries, but you will find here for Anopheles gambiae, and we will find from 85 till 95% achievement, the efficiency of killing or controlling malaria could be achieved using this simple technique. I'm saying that really simple technique, and here for the Culex vibrans, more or less even we will find also better results. It reached 100%, and it is enough for 21 days to regenerate the process for another purposes. Here, for the third type of the species, Aedes aegypti, you will find how the percentage of survival as a function of sunlight exposure time per minute. You will find it's so efficient, because in this area also, the light intensity is very huge. Here, my co-workers and some working people from Uganda, and even we as academics were always happy to see that really some public or some media interest on that product, and you will see here some articles, Egyptian firm fight malaria. Here you will find another one, new anti-malaria product tested since it started 2008, real field studies in Uganda, and even the All Africa website. It is written here, Uganda non-toxic remedy for malaria, and explains also our product. The conclusions, the obtained results reveal that in chlorophyll derivatives with direct sunlight could be used as an innovative modality for malaria, filaria, and schistosomiasis and agriculture pests. And we are very proud that we'll see it combines efficiency, low cost, safety, and environmentally friendly. And here, the future perspective, we have succeeded after struggling 5 years with the WHO to recognize. We got this recognition from WHO, and here you it's written, based on the evidence presented safe, false, within a previously defined paradigm larvicides. And they said, products falling within already defined paradigms don't need to demonstrate public health efficacy through community trials. This means that it's a real recognition of WHO that this product could be used and utilized for malaria, or the larvicides to control malaria. The broad here, another important point, last month I was invited by the African Developing Bank in Africa, and they want, and they posted that on the, in their websites, and they say Egyptian innovation, a green cure for malaria, and they asked me that to do awareness about the countries in Africa that the bank will support, will finance to proceed the pilot studies like what we did in Ethiopia or in Uganda. Here, the acknowledgement of my co-workers. Without them, I couldn't tell you any word about the all the stories. And this is marks the Nile started its long journey of the Mediterranean through central and northern Uganda, Sudan, and Egypt. This place here is Victoria Lake in Uganda, and the water comes from here. That is the zero point to start till it reach to Alexandria in Cairo. It needs about 3 months. And thank you for your attention. And last point, the product, we have this product, it is circulated by Professor Van der Rijn. Thank you for your attention. Thank you.
So thank you very much for the nice presentation. Professor Mahmoud can answer one or two questions if you have any in the audience.
Thank you for the interesting lecture on this very important and relatively neglected disease. And two questions. Could you please detail what did the Stockholm conference refer to PDT? You mentioned it in the beginning of your lecture. I did not understand. Stockholm conference, you said something. And the second question, why would the whitefly ingest the chlorophyll?
Okay, the first question I didn't get exactly. I didn't hear that. Can you repeat it again, please?
Stockholm, you mentioned some problem with Stockholm conference against PDT, I thought, but I didn't understand.
DDT is still used for malaria control vector in Africa. And WHO allowed to do that.
Allowed it.
Allowed to do that, irrespective of it is really totally banned according to Stockholm Convention. But DDT, you know, that is very dangerous. That is a very persistent organic compound, and it make all the life ecosystem really very bad. It is not environmentally friendly at all. And but they don't have any alternative so far. But with this product, we hope that after the recognition of them, it could be used as alternative to DDT.
Yes. And the second question was about the white fly ingesting the chlorophyll. Why should we take the chlorophyll?
It is really a surprise in the field. We found that if you spray into the trees of the tomato or cotton worm, you will find that this the white fly eats this, because we have some attractant additive only specific for white fly. We had another patent regarding house fly. House fly, you can have it in beet with sugar and attract it with hormone, and you can eat something and then fly in the sun, it will be killed without any pesticides. We have this patented already since 4 years ago.
Thank you.
With pleasure.
Okay, so one more question.
I'll be very brief. Thank you very much for an excellent lecture about one of these neglected diseases, including sleeping sickness as well, which is also, these diseases are considered diseases of the third world, and therefore a lot of really good medication for treatment have never seen the sunlight because of lack of funding, because the pharmaceutical companies are not really interested in these because they're considered, you know, poor countries, and therefore there is no profit in that. Having said that, aiming the treatment to the victor may have a side effect, which would basically mosquitoes are a good source of food for a lot of other ecology, you know, some other animals and which feed on the insects themselves. So can we find a cure for rest removing the disease rather than the victor, which is another problem in there?
Yes, okay, it's very interesting questions. We are looking only to control the disease from the source, really. We are not, because for drugs for malaria, there is a lot existing, even for diagnostic as well as for treatment. But unfortunately, nowadays, according to the latest WHO also report, they say that is resistance coming from the using of these drugs. And that is why it is dangerous. In our case, utilizing photodynamic therapy or the modality, you have complete damage. You don't have any chance for resistance coming by utilizing this technique.